Welcome to RoboSquid TV. I'm Kyle, and together we're going to make beautiful websites. That's right, this time our websites will actually be beautiful. Well, maybe not beautiful, but we'll get the foundation going. Welcome back if you are starting from our first video, Intro to HTML, and hello new devs. If you are new to HTML, please go back and watch that first video. I promise it's worth it. Today we are going to be learning about the basics of CSS, the language used to give life to our HTML. Like with all of our classes, files for this course can be found in the description below. CSS stands for Cascading Style Sheets. Remember that, it's going to be important later. CSS is how we tell our browser what font we want or how big that font should be, the color, the spacing, controls the layout of our page, arranges and resizes items, everything. Over the next few videos, we're going to master the basics of CSS, so let's start at the beginning. CSS is its own language different from HTML and typically written in a separate .css file. HTML tells your browser what content we are displaying on the page, but CSS tells the browser how we want it displayed. Create a style.css file in the same directory as your index.html file. You can name your file anything you want as long as it has the .css extension. Now, to tell your browser to download this style sheet along with the rest of your website, we need to instruct it to do so. Go into your index.html file and add the following line to your head element. As we learned in the last video, the link tag is used to include external resources. This line will load in our CSS file for us. Now then, let's get on to the good stuff. In our CSS file, we need to create a CSS declaration block, which consists of a selector, which defines what we are trying to style, and declarations inside of curly braces, which are our styling rules. In this case, our selector will be for the HTML element h1. Inside, we will have a property paired with a value, separated by a colon, and will be followed by a semicolon to notate that this is the end of the rule. We have a lot of properties to choose from, but if we, for example, want to set our color property and give it a value of blue, you can see that the text in our h1 element has turned blue. You can combine properties and values to create different styles. Let's make it an example site, and in the body, we'll place a main element and create a few articles inside with the article element. A simplified version of an article might look like an article element with our heading and a paragraph. Let's create a header container and place our h1 heading inside along with our article title. And below the header, we'll insert a paragraph. And in this example, we'll forego the footer. Let's duplicate this article 4 times to simulate multiple articles. And back in our CSS, we'll select the paragraph elements and inside write a rule to change the font size to something larger. We can do that with the property font-size, and we'll use the value 18 pixels. You'll notice that all of the paragraphs got larger in size. Let's return the font size to the default. Now, what if we want to select certain elements, not just all paragraphs, what about just one? This is where ID and class come in. ID and class are HTML attributes you can give any HTML element to help us when selecting elements we want to style. Now, class and ID attributes work exactly the same way, but the ID attribute is used to give a unique identifier to an element so we can target it directly. Each unique ID should appear only once on the page. No two elements should have the same ID. Class, on the other hand, is just the opposite. Class is used to show that all elements sharing the same class should share the same styling rules. When picking your ID or class name, it is important to pick something that first of all makes sense, but also you'll likely want to follow some kind of structure. One practice I highly recommend is called camel case. Classes and IDs cannot contain a space in their name. A common practice is to write the first word in all lowercase, and any following word, the first letter is capitalized. Try to keep your names short but readable. Let's make the first article on our page a featured article. Since we are only going to have one, we'll give the first article element on the page an ID with a value of article featured. Back in our CSS, let's give our new featured post a gold background color. Before, when we wanted to select all instances of an element, we typed the element name as the selector. Well, there are quite a few other kinds of selectors, but let's go over two more real quick, and we'll talk about more in another video. The ID selector is represented by a hashtag or pound sign followed by the ID value, and the class selector is a period followed by the class value. So once we've selected our featured post, we'll give it a background color of gold. And if you take a look at our page, we have a golden featured post. Now, to demonstrate classes, let's mark the second and last post as hot or trending posts. Since there will be multiple of them, let's make a CSS class. Since we're already in our CSS, we'll start here by selecting the class, which we will name Article Hot. Let's give it a background color of red, and while we're at it, let's change the color to white. In our HTML, we will assign the Article Hot class to our post and then refresh. Check it out. Our hot articles are now showing in red with white text. Remember we mentioned that CSS stands for Cascading Style Sheets? Well, notice what's happening on the page. We never told our H1 or paragraph tag to appear in white. We told the article element that its color was set to white. In CSS, styling rules flow downward and are inherited by the children elements nested within. Because we didn't tell our text to be any other color otherwise, it inherited the style from the parent, article. One last selector for this video. Let's change the color of the H1 elements only inside the hot articles. To do this, we first select the article hot class and then a space and put the next selector of what we were targeting inside the hot article element. In our case, we are targeting the heading, and so we will write H1. And we will make the color the same color gold as our feature post. Now we have overwritten the inherited white text by selecting the element directly and assigning it a color. We could have, of course, given the H1 inside of our article hot class its own class name and selected that, but what we have done is much easier to work with since we deal with the entire article as one single component. One last thing we'll do is resize our main element. Right now our articles are stretching across the whole width of the page. What if we want to make it so they only take up about half the page? Right now the articles are as wide as their parent object. So if we change the width property of our parent element, the main, we can resize the articles. Let's give our main a width of 50%. Because we used a percentage and not a pixel value, the width will be half of the page no matter what size our screen is. Okay, we understand the very basics of CSS, but everything is still kind of stacked up on top of each other and there's no spacing. Up next, we'll learn about margins, padding, and the CSS box model. Thank you for watching. If you liked what you saw, be sure to like the video and tell others what you saw. And if you want to see more, make sure you subscribe. If you still need more, we have a Facebook and Twitter. Make sure to follow.